Okay, so let's start with this topic, which is vapor absorption system. So as you have already covered some part at least of vapor compression refrigeration system, so we will be keeping that as a base for starting with this vapor absorption system. Now, as you have studied in the vapor compression system, we are having four different parts of the system by which that refrigeration cycle works. So out of those four parts, the heart of the system was compressor, but in this particular system, vapor absorption system, that compressor has been replaced with a complete system. So a component has been replaced with a system, and the work or function of compressor would be accomplished by a three-step process. So that three-step process will be by the use of absorber, pump and generator. So we are having three components, and those three components will be replacing one component. So from that vapor compression cycle, vapor absorption cycle is replacing compressor with a system of absorber, pump and a generator. So basically, what is the function of compressor in the vapor compression cycle? It is to raise the pressure of the refrigerant gas to a higher pressure, so that higher pressure gas can then be condensed into a higher pressure liquid refrigerant, which can then be used again in the evaporator of the system for taking up latent heat of evaporation and get evaporated. So for the refrigeration system, what we require is, we require a liquid refrigerant at a sufficient high pressure so that its latent heat can be supplied by a colder system or a colder surroundings. So what do we mean by this is, we need to raise the pressure of the refrigerant, liquid refrigerant, to such a value that its boiling point at reduced pressure, when we reduce the pressure, its boiling point is less than the evaporator temperature. So to just to explain you this thing, you kindly look on to this figure. So in this figure, what is shown, we are having this component E is evaporator, C is condenser, and we are having this valve here shown by this circle with a cross mark. This is expansion valve. So these three components are the component from the vapor compression refrigeration system, and other components, whatever is there in this figure, are replacing the compressor. So here you can just follow the cycle, that from the condenser, refrigerant is going via this line to this expansion valve shown to you here, and after this expansion valve, when it has reduced the pressure, the refrigerant goes to this component shown as E, which is an evaporator of the refrigerant system, refrigeration system, and after evaporator, it goes to compressor, which has been replaced here by this system. So these three components are older one, and what we are doing here in this case is, we are having this A, which is absorber, P, which is pump, G, which is generator, and again one another valve, just like this expansion valve shown to you here. This is a pressure reducing valve. The work of this valve is same as is the case with expansion valve. So this is also a throttling valve. Its work is to reduce the pressure. So what is shown on these axis, as this is drawn on X and Y axis, just like graph paper. So on the X axis, we are having temperature. So temperature has been shown on the X axis, means whatever has been shown towards the right is having higher temperature from the other components which have been shown towards the left part. Then when we go in the vertical direction, here on the Y axis we have PP is for pressure. So whatever has been shown in the bottom parts are having at a lower pressure, are operating at lower pressures than as compared to the parts which are shown at the top or above parts. So this is regarding the pressure for this system. So what we can see here is that condenser is at the highest pressure in the older three components. Then expansion valve is in between the condenser pressure and evaporator pressure. evaporator pressure is having the lowest pressure out of these three components, not overall vapor compression absorption cycle. So evaporator is having the lowest pressure. So what happens? This expansion valve reduces the pressure of refrigerant, liquid refrigerant, to a condition where its boiling point is low enough so that it can receive this heat Q naught. So here you can see this Q naught shown with this arrow and this black body which has been shown. This is a cold body, and this is what is required to be maintained at a lower temperature. So this is our refrigerated space, and it is at a temperature T naught, which is lowest of all in this graph. And this evaporator can still receive heat from this coldest body out of these all bodies shown on this diagram, and this heat energy Q naught will be received by the evaporator. So due to that increase in the heat energy, it will evaporate the liquid refrigerant going into the evaporator, changing its phase from liquid to vapor phase, and that liquid to vapor phase conversion will not change the temperature, but will increase the, will change the phase from liquid to vapor. So overall enthalpy will increase, the phase will change, and then this vapor refrigerant will leave at conditions 8 via this pipeline to the next component. So are you clear regarding this older three components which I have shown you in this diagram?
Yes, sir.
So what happens next? In the vapor compression cycle, it was that from the evaporator, the refrigerant would be going to the compressor, which will raise the pressure of this low pressure refrigerant gas to a high pressure refrigerant gas. And as a result of increase in pressure, simultaneously it also used to increase the temperature as well. So raising the temperature was not the duty or was not the work of the compressor, but it was a side effect. It was not required, but as it is a physical system, temperature and pressure are directly correlated. So due to increase in pressure, the temperature increases by itself, and that increase in pressure, temperature was also required to be cooled down further in the condenser part. But as we are replacing the compressor, the duty of compressor has to be then dealt with the replacement system which we are proposing or which we are putting in place of compressor. So what is that part of system? Here you can just see we are having four components which are replacing the compressor. This is absorber, then we are having a P pump, this is pump shown to you here, then this GG is generator, also it is sometimes referred to as a reboiler, and this valve shown to you here, this is pressure reducing valve. So what happens? That low temperature, low pressure vapor refrigerant at conditions 8 goes to the absorber, where it is absorbed into a weak solution of refrigerant in a solvent. So what is there in absorber? We are having a solution. In that solution, there are two major components. One component is that solvent in which the refrigerant will be absorbed. So basically it is dissolving the gas into liquid. So we are having a solution which is in liquid phase, and here you can see the temperature and pressure state of this absorber. We are having a pressure lower than evaporator pressure, and the temperature is higher than evaporator. So it is a bit hot than evaporator and at lower pressure. So due to this low pressure at absorber, it sucks the vapors from evaporator as it is connected through this line here. So it is sucking the vapor refrigerant at low temperature, low pressure state into the absorber. In the evaporator, those gaseous state, low temperature, low pressure, gaseous state vapor refrigerant will get absorbed into the liquid solution present inside the absorber, and I have already told you that it is a weak solution. What do we mean by weak is that the concentration of refrigerant in that solution is less, so it is having a lesser value. As we are having comparison with other component, that is generator, we are saying this is weak solution with respect to the solution present in generator. How it is weak, you will be just knowing it in a moment. So what happens, as we are having this absorber which is absorbing refrigerant, there is some evolution of heat of absorption, as well as we are having a higher temperature steam coming back to the absorber from this part. So at state 3 there is something coming back to the absorber. So when we are reaching this part, I will be explaining what is coming back to the absorber. So here you are seeing it is at a higher temperature. So to maintain the temperature of absorber at the value at which it is working, we are required to reject some heat. So this QA amount of heat is rejected to this ambient air or atmosphere. So it is rejected to this ambient conditions, QA amount of heat. So here A is for absorber, Q is for heat. Here Q was heat and not is first one. So this is in what we are interested in. So overall the target of this system is to maximize this Q naught value and to minimize this T naught value. So basically, as this is a refrigeration system, we are required to increase the amount of heat transfer which is possible from the evaporator and also decrease the temperature which can be maintained at the evaporator. So this is the cold body which is our target. We are required to maintain this cold body at a colder temperature. Okay, so this QA amount of heat is rejected to this ambient condition. So here we are seeing this dotted line which is showing the temperature. TA is equal to TC equal to TK. So what is TA? TA is the temperature of absorber, TC is the temperature of condenser, and TK is the temperature of ambient atmosphere or outside temperature. Are you getting these three terms, TA, TC, TK?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, this absorber is rejecting the heat to the outside conditions, and then the solution which has been generated now in the absorber will be having some increased concentration of refrigerant in that particular solvent. So overall solution's concentration of refrigerant increases. So the weak solution of refrigerant in the absorber now turns to a bit stronger solution than before of the refrigerant in the solvent, which will be now at conditions 4. And it would be pumped by this pump P to this generator. So here you can see this line. This line is supplying this condition 4 material to this condition 1 material at G. Why the condition has changed now? Because pump is also supplying some energy in the form of either increase in temperature or pressure, because pump will be pumping the material. It will be increasing its pressure as well as a bit of temperature. So here you can see this condition 4 and 1, they are at different horizontal location. So condition 1 is at a hotter side, condition 4 is at a colder side. And with respect to vertical direction also, we can see condition 4 is at a lower position, condition 1 is at a higher position. So pressure has also changed. So as per this graph, we are having lesser pressure at condition 4, higher pressure at condition 1, and these change in conditions with respect to temperature and pressure is due to this pumping role of this pump and the work of this pump which is pumping. So the same percentage concentration which has been supplied by the absorber is here also. So we are having a richer or stronger solution of refrigerant sent to the generator. So in the generator what happens, as we are having some heat exchange going on in the absorber, same will be the case in the generator. So this absorber is a heat exchanger, just like evaporator is a heat exchanger, condenser is a heat exchanger, absorber is also a heat exchanger, and so is the generator. So evaporator rejects heat, generator receives heat. So here you are seeing QH amount of heat being received by the generator from a hot body. So we are having a source of heat required in this case, which will be supplying QH amount of heat energy into the generator. And what this generator will do, as it is being heated by this heat source hot body and QH amount of heat energy has been put into the system, it boils off the refrigerant which was absorbed into the solution. So at this generator's operating conditions, at this particular pressure and this particular temperature, what happens? Generator starts evolving the refrigerant vapors again. Now, as we had increased the pressure of the solution which was supplied here, so the vapor being evolved from the generator are vapors of refrigerant at high pressure than before, which was supplied by the evaporator, and also you can see at a higher temperature. As per this graph, this condition 5 is at a higher temperature than this condition 7 or 8. So the work of compressor has been achieved by this system. The work of compressor was to change the state of refrigerant coming from the evaporator. So refrigerant was coming in the vapor phase, low temperature, low pressure state, and it was to be changed into vapor phase, high pressure, high temperature state, which has been achieved by these three components here. Now this particular pipeline, which is shown in between this condition 2 and 3, this is connected via this pressure reducing valve, because what we will be having in generator of this after this particular condition is that the generator will now, as it has removed or boiled off the refrigerant, it will now be having a weaker solution of refrigerant, because not 100% absorbed refrigerant will get evolved, will get boiled off. Some part will still remain in the solution. So we will be having a weak solution of refrigerant remaining in the generator, which will be circulated back to the absorber so as to maintain the levels of solution in both generator and absorber. So there will be a recycling of this solution. So weak solution at high temperature, high pressure state is going via this pressure reducing valve. Pressure reducing valve is reducing the pressure. So the pressure, as you can see in the vertical axis, the condition 2 high pressure, condition 3 lower pressure than before. So reduced pressure, weak solution coming back to the absorber, but still, as we are having a lesser pipeline length and also there was no heat exchanger involved in between, so we are receiving this condition 3 weak solution at a higher temperature as well. So now what happens, as we are receiving weak solution at a higher temperature from the generator via this pressure reducing valve to the absorber, its heat content is required to be removed to maintain the temperature of absorber. So that is why this QA amount of heat has to be rejected to the ambient conditions. And now from the generator, the condition 5, which is high temperature, high pressure vapor refrigerant, will go to the compressor condenser, and the cycle, refrigerant cycle, will repeat itself. So this is in short the working of vapor absorption system, refrigeration system. If you have understood up till this part, you just let me know.
Yes, sir.
So what happens, basically what we did in this case is we have replaced compressor, which was a component, with a whole complete new system, which is comprising of four components: an absorber, a pump, generator and a pressure reducing valve. So what have we gained in this case? So basically we have increased the capital cost, which should not be there, to make the system economic, but we have also gained something. The gain here is that we are reducing the amount of power required, because we have replaced the compressor, which was consuming a lot of electrical energy, with a pump, which is the only moving component in whole system now in this case. And this pump will be consuming very little power as compared to compressor. Compressor will consume a very great amount of power, because its role is to mainly compress the refrigerant and also maintain the flow of refrigerant in the cycle. Now here pump will just be letting the refrigerant flow. Its role is not to increase the pressure. Increase in pressure is achieved by increase in concentration of refrigerant in the solution. So at the absorber we are having weak solution, it is absorbing refrigerant, it is converting into rich solution. Rich solution has been pumped, and from the rich solution after boiling we receive refrigerant vapors in higher concentration. So as we are receiving refrigerant in higher concentration means higher flow rate through the same system, and that is why we are increasing the pressure also. So compressing work has been converted or replaced with absorption and generation. In the case of generator, it is reboiling the solution and absorber is absorbing the incoming vapors. So what we did is we reduced the overall power requirement but also utilized a heat source. In the case of compressor, this hot body QH amount of heat that was not required. But here what we can do is the solution, or we can say solvent, is selected such that the solution which will be produced, rich solution or weak solution, its boiling in the generator can be done by using some waste heat source or some heat source which is not having any cost component associated with it. For example, we can use solar energy to heat, to supply heat to the generator. We can heat some thermic fluid, water or any other kind of substance by solar energy, and that can be provided to heat the generator because this generator is a heat exchanger and we are required to have some hot body. So that hot body, it can be exhaust from the boiler flue gases, it can be exhaust from the engines, exhaust flue gases from the engines, IC engines, external combustion engines, or whatever any waste heat energy source we are having. It may be condensate, steam condensate from the processing equipments. So we are having many sources of waste heat energy, which heat energy of that sources which is not in a usable form can be utilized here. So the major energy which is required in the system is in this form, QH, is in the form of heat energy, and that can be freely available, and very less energy is required in this pumping. Rest of the components are static, they are not having any great amount of energy required. So we will be having, as compared to this heat energy QH, negligible amount of energy required at other components. So this QC is heat rejected by the compressor also at this ambient conditions. So is this clear?
Yes, sir.
So
yes,
what
sir.
We are having is, we are having a replacement of compressor by especially these three components. So we are having absorber, I have already told you what it is doing, then pump, then generator. Generator, we are having three names. It is called as a generator, it is called as desorber, and also called as reboiler. Are you following this? Yes. So this can come in your objective type questions, just like pick the odd one out. The of the options can be this, another can be some other thing. So you must know that these three are the same thing. Okay, now coming on to the analysis part. So this is the energy balance. So overall input energies will be equal to sum of input energies will be equal to sum of output. So we are having Q0, QP, QH going into the system, QC and QA coming out of the system. Here you can see Q0 going into the system, QH going into the system, QP will pumping power going into the system. Then QC coming out, QA coming out. So we are having Q0 in QP pump, which is in QH heat source, which is also input, and QC condenser heat out of the system, QA absorber also out of the system. So this is the energy balance, and overall this is QK which is rejected to the environment because QC and QA are both rejected to the environment. So this is representing the net heat rejected to the environment, which is this sum of QC plus QA. And as we are having very less pumping power, if this equation you already know from the thermodynamics classes, so we are having very negligible part. So what we will be dealing here is, we will be dealing with the specific quantities. Specific quantities means we are required to have some base, and that base will be the mass of vapor distilled. So mass of vapor distilled is kept as D, capital D. So if we divide that Q0 by D, we get this small Q0. So we are replacing, or we are rearranging these equations. So in that form, we will be having this equation. You just see that this is also small Q. It has been misprinted in the book. So same equation with the specific quantities. Now what is the refrigeration, this overall COP of the system? Overall COP of the system is denoted by this Greek symbol xi. So this is the Greek symbol xi because it is not the same four component system which was before. Now here we will be having a different relationship to have overall coefficient of performance, because as it is a performance sum, for performance what we need is, we need output divided by input. Output of the system is its target part. The target part is this Q naught. Overall, any refrigeration system is applied or it is used to deliver this heat Q naught out of the cold body. So this is the output, and it would be divided by overall input. So output is Q naught, and overall input into the system which we supplied was QH and QP. So this QH and QP were supplied to the system. QC and QA were neither supplied to the system, and we have not done anything additional to reject this out of the system in the simplest case. So this is not supplied to the system. The input energy was at pump and from this heat source. So Q naught divided by sum of QP plus QH will be the COP of the system. Okay, and QH plus QP from this equation can be converted into this, so which is QK. So here you can see QH and QP plus Q naught is equals to QK. So what we can have is this QH plus QP from this equation, QH plus QP equal to QK minus Q naught. Are you getting this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so which will be roughly equal to Q naught by QH. So from this previous expression, as this QP pumping power as compared to this both Q naught and QH is negligible, we can neglect it, and we can have this expression, this first one only, reduced to this Q naught plus QH. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
So this is overall coefficient of performance. Now coming on to its more analysis, a deeper analysis. So what has happened in this system? We can see that this system is comprising of two cycles working together. One cycle is for this solution which has been recirculated in between absorber and generator by using pump on this side and pressure reducing valve on this side. So in this part of the system we are having a cycle of solution, but in other part which is involving this evaporator, expansion valve and condenser, and with in combination with whole of this system, this is involving only refrigerant, no solution. So we are having a refrigerant circuit separate from the solution circuit. So in the refrigerant circuit part, this is the component or this is the cycle which is our refrigeration machine part of the system, and this other system or cycle which is having solution to be handled is the heat pump part. So this particular part which is involving absorber, pump, generator and pressure reducing valve is forming a heat engine. So what happens is, basically what we need is, for running a refrigeration system we need a source of energy. So this absorber generator cycle, this is a heat engine, not pump. I mistakenly said that heat pump. It is not heat pump, it is an heat engine. You just see here that what happens in a heat engine. In the case of heat engine, as you have studied in your thermodynamics classes, heat engine has a heat source and a heat sink. It works between two temperatures. It receives heat from the heat source, do some work, and rejects the residual amount of heat energy to the heat sink. And again, the same working material which it was having to receive the heat, to do work and to reject the heat, is circulated back again, and it again receives heat, do some work, reject heat. So the same thing is happening here at the generator. The working system, working substance here is the solution of refrigerant, whether it is weak or strong. It is receiving heat QH, then it is rejecting heat QA. QA is being rejecting, this is rejecting heat to a lower temperature body which is ambient. QH is being received from a hot body, so this is heat source, this is heat sink. So this heat engine is working in between these two temperatures TH and TK, or we can say TA, TK, TC and TA all are same. So it is receiving heat, it is then being circulated back again, rejecting heat at the absorber. Are you getting this part of the system?
Yes, sir.
So what happens here is that in this part, this is the heat engine part and this part is the refrigeration machine part. So heat engine supplies energy to the refrigeration machine for working. So basically you can understand it by this diagram. So here you can see this diagram. In this diagram what is shown? We are having heat source at TH temperature. It is supplying QH amount of heat to the heat engine. E is for engine. So this is a heat engine working between TK and TH temperatures. QH amount of heat is received by the heat engine. It is doing work and that work has been supplied to this R, which is a refrigeration machine. QA amount of heat energy rejected to the sink for this heat engine part. But for refrigeration part, what it does? It receives heat from the heat sink. So heat sink for the refrigeration machine is the cold body at T naught temperature. Heat received is Q naught. And it receives heat from a colder body, rejects to a higher temperature body, QC. So to invert or reverse the direction of heat flow, it requires some external work. So that external work or power or energy is supplied by this heat engine to the refrigeration machine to do this work. So are you seeing this combination? Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
So what we are having here is this heat engine part, which is the solution circuit, it is working in the state 1, 2, 3, 4. This refrigeration machine part, which is the refrigerant circuit, it is 5, 6, 7, 8. So here you can see heat engine part working in the states 1, 2, 3, 4. This is the heat engine cycle. And this 5, 6, 7 and 8. This is the refrigerant cycle. So overall, we can say this vapor absorption system is a heat operating refrigeration machine. Are you getting this?
Yes, sir.
So basically this is a heat operating refrigeration machine. So here you can see. So basically this is like this. Now as we have now just seen or realized that we are dealing with two different systems in combination. So both of systems will be having their own efficiencies. For refrigeration system part, it is called as the COP of the system. For heat engine part, it is called as thermal efficiency of the system. And in overall case, we will be calling it as overall coefficient of performance. Overall coefficient of performance we have already discussed here. It can be also discussed again in this manner, that overall efficiency or overall COP of this heat operated refrigeration machine is Q naught by QH. By neglecting that pumping power, it was from here you can see just Q naught by QH it was. So Q naught by QH, from this diagram we can see that engine is supplying work. So let us say this work is W, that work W has been supplied to this refrigeration machine. So we can multiply and divide with this work both sides. So we are having two fractions, W by QH, this is the thermal efficiency of this heat engine. So for heat engine, output was work, input was this QH. So this part W by QH, this is Neta TH, which is thermal efficiency of heat pump. And Q naught by W, Q naught was target for this refrigeration machine and this W work was supplied. So Q naught by work W, this is its COP, and this COP is also in the other form being represented to you here. So this EC, this is COP, this is for COP. So the coefficient of performance of vapor absorption system, this is Q naught by H, it is not a very simple term, it is a combination or we can say multiplication of two efficiency terms. So this overall COP of this vapor absorption system depends on thermal efficiency of heat pump part, heat engine part and COP of the refrigeration machine part. So it would be lower than the lowest of these two both. As we know that the thermal efficiency of the, not lower than the lowest, the it would be lower than the COP of refrigeration system part. The thermal efficiency of the heat engine will be less than 1 or it would be less than 100%, and COP of the refrigerant refrigeration machine will be higher than 1, but overall multiplication will bring that down. So it cannot be directly compared with the vapor compression system. For vapor compression system, this was the overall COP, but for this vapor absorption, it is Q0/H. So both are different. So if we say see regarding Carnot, which is will be turning it into maximum performance. So this Xi max, which is overall coefficient of performance maximum which can be achieved, is thermal efficiency Carnot and this COP Carnot, which is in the terms of temperature from the thermodynamics lessons. You can see it can be written as this, which can be also rearranged in this particular form. And we can see to maximize this value from this expression, what we can see is TH should be high, as high as possible, because it is in the denominator and this term is being subtracted. So if TH is as high as possible, we will be having overall multiplication value as high as possible also, because this expression has been minus, it is being subtracted. Then TK as low as possible. So from here you can see just by analysis that TK should be as low as possible and T naught should be as high as possible. So T naught is the refrigerated space temperature. So this would be the value of the maximum efficiency by replacing these terms, because here we are having this TK is this TK and this TK, these both are same, and these are TA absorber temperature, TC is the condenser. So this is the refrigeration machine part using TC, and this is the heat engine part using TA. So this numerical you can just go through and solve for yourself, very small numerical. Now tell me, is there any query for this particular part which we have discussed till now? Which type of system has
higher coefficient of performance? Means in comparison with the absorption system and compression system.
Vapor compression system as compared to absorption system will have higher COP. Here you can see that Xi max here it is coming out to be 0.34. When you solve numericals for compression system, it always come out to be more than 1. But in the case of absorption, it generally comes out to be less than 1. Here also you can see the COP of refrigeration part was more, but thermal efficiency is very poor. Okay then. So in the last class, we had discussed up till this numerical exercise. So in this numerical exercise, we had seen that to calculate the performance of vapor absorption refrigeration system by using this Carnot relationship, it was coming out to be this particular value. And out of this, we have seen that we are having in this formula two performance terms being multiplied. So this first performance term here is the performance of the heat pump, or not heat pump, heat engine part of the system, and this side 3.69, this is COP of the refrigeration system. So basically overall performance of the system, we have seen that it has greatly reduced. So COP of refrigeration system, in spite of being of this particular value which is considered to be good, 3.69 COP is a good value for a refrigeration system, has been reduced drastically to a value of 0.34. So how and why has it happened is because of this, and this is the thermal efficiency or thermal performance of the heat engine part of the system. So we are seeing that heat engine part of this particular system is very, very inefficient, and that is why it is bringing down the overall efficiency to a very great extent. And that is a very, we can say, a major factor or major player to bring down the efficiency of the system as such. But otherwise, as per the refrigeration side of the system, it is performing very good, but due to this heat engine part, it is performing very badly. But we cannot say it as a very bad performance because of that we are utilizing a waste heat energy source or a heat energy source which is freely available, because here you can see that it was operated by solar heat. Temperature is reaching 1110 degrees Celsius. So as we know that solar energy is a renewable source of energy and it is available freely, and hence whatever useful work or useful energy we can extract out of it is free or is not a very bad choice. So it is a good choice. So that is why, as the operational cost of the system is significantly very less as compared to conventional vapor compression system, the efficiency or the performance of the system at the value of 0.34 is not bad. Okay, so here we are seeing that this performance, as shown to you here, is at this particular value, and as this is operated by solar energy, so it is a good performance as such. Now, before going on to further studies regarding this common refrigerant absorbent pair, important point which we have come across up to this part is that the performance of vapor absorption system is significantly lower as compared to vapor compression system, but still, as we are having an advantage, a major advantage of it being practically or significantly very less or minimum cost of operation, hence it is advantageous to use. So you can have an idea that why should we use vapor absorption system over vapor compression system. So we can have several advantages to be listed. Out of them, four of them I will be telling you. You can note them down. It may come in the examination and it is not written in this book. So first point is that it does not have moving parts, because in the vapor compression system we were having compressor, which was a heavy duty machine, makes a lot of noise, requires a lot of maintenance, attention during operation and before and after operation, and it is very nice. But as compared to compressor in the vapor compression system, here in this system we are having a pump. Pump as compared to compressor does not make a noise as significant. Secondly, it is not costly to maintain the pump. So what we will be having is, with respect to no moving parts, we are having 2 points, that it is having lesser noise and lesser maintenance cost. Then second advantage is that it can be used on any readily available heat source. So what are we having is, we are having a free operation. Hence, if we are having a flue gas outlet at a higher temperature than ambient temperature, that can be used as a prime source of energy to run this vapor absorption system. We can also use solar heat energy. We can also use some condensate, steam condensate from the processing equipment, and similar kind of discharges at a higher temperature than ambient temperature can be used to run this type of system, which cannot be used for running of vapor compression system. So this is an added advantage in the case of vapor absorption system. So they work almost free during operation. Then third point can be presence of liquid leaving the evaporator has no detrimental effect except less refrigeration effect. So what does that mean? It means that if we are having any liquid leaving the condenser.
Sir,
what
is 2020-21? Does it receive signal but at melting machine?
No, that evaporator. Here in this diagram you see that if we are having a normal vapor compression cycle, then after evaporator we will be having a compressor. And if liquid refrigerant, in whether they are that is in small quantity, if it is leaving the evaporator entering the compressor, then it has a detrimental effect on the working of compressor, as liquids are practically incompressible, and as the liquids cannot be compressed, the liquid whichever is leaving the evaporator will be having a detrimental effect, negative effect on the working of compressor. But here in this system, if we are having any liquid leaving the evaporator, there will be no such detrimental effect, because after evaporator, no matter whether it was liquid or it was gas, it was to be absorbed in the absorber into a weak solution of refrigerant. So whether we are having liquid getting out of the evaporator or gas coming out of the evaporator, it was finally to be absorbed and made into a solution. So that is why there will be no such detrimental effects as is in the case of vapor compression system. But what we will be having is, if liquid is leaving the evaporator, we will be having only less refrigeration effect than what could it have produced. So that will be same for compression system as well as absorption system. If liquid is leaving evaporator, refrigeration effect which it could have produced is less. So this is one more advantage. Then a final point to the advantage of vapor absorption system is that same efficiency at reduced load as on full load can be produced. So what we are having is, we are having the efficiency as fixed, whether we are having load at full load or less than full load. So what does this load or full load or less load mean? It means at the evaporator, which is the target part of the system to produce refrigeration effect, if we are having a requirement to cool it quickly, so what we are having is, we are having more cooling load at the evaporator, which is to be taken up by the refrigeration system, whether it is compression system or absorption system. So if the load in the evaporator is increased up to the full load, or whether it is decreased to a very less value than the full load as compared to the full load, there is no reduction in the efficiency. And in the case of vapor compression system, it is having a reduction in efficiency. How and why does that happen? It is because load reductions are met by simply varying the flow of heating medium. So in the case of vapor absorption system, the rate of flow of heating medium here at this part, in the generator part, if there is more load at the evaporator, we can change the flow rate of heating medium, we can increase it so that more and more vapors of refrigerant are produced. So more fast flow rate of refrigerant will be there in the refrigeration circuit, and hence the increased load requirement would be met. If we are having lesser load requirement than at the peak load, so peak load is its rated load capacity, if load increases over and above that, then any system will fail, not only vapor compression or absorption. For any system, whatever is its designed capacity, it will fail over and above that value after a certain factor of safety. But below that value, the efficiency term, how it is maintained here, is that if we are having less load in the evaporator, less heating medium can be flown in the generator, so less amount of refrigerant vapors will be produced at this point 5 and less refrigerant will be circulating through the refrigerant circuit, and hence the mass flow rate of refrigerant is maintained, could be maintained in such a way that it meets the load requirement. So there will be complete evaporation of refrigerant at point 8, no liquid will be leaving. Otherwise what will happen, there will be a loss of energy, because if we are putting liquid into the evaporator and getting liquid out of the evaporator, that not total cooling load which it could take has been served by that evaporator, by that refrigerant. So we are required to reduce the mass flow rate, and that can be done by reducing this heat transfer fluid in the generator. But in the case of compressor systems, what happens? If we are reducing the load, then compressors are having their own RPM. They are running on a fixed RPM. So what will happen? They are serving the system at a fixed mass flow rate. If not mass flow rate, then at least a volumetric flow rate of vapor is served by the compressor. So if load requirement at evaporator is less, then also same volumetric flow rate is required at the compressor. If load is more, then also same volumetric flow rate is at the compressor. So if as the system is designed for its full capacity working, the compressor can run or will run at its rated capacity, at its RPM, so that it can serve for a highest mass flow rate required, and hence the overall mass flow rate throughout the system will be maintained by the compressor. But when the load at the evaporator reduces, then what happens? The compressor is starving for the vapor refrigerant from the evaporator, because evaporator is not serving vapor refrigerant to the compressor, because load has reduced. As the load has reduced, rate of evaporation has reduced. As the rate of evaporation has reduced, then mass of refrigerant converted from liquid to vapor at evaporator has reduced. So less vapors will be going to the compressor and less volumetric flow rate will be there. So what will happen is the compressor will continue its work and it will produce very low pressure at the suction side, and that can be detrimental to the system in its physical form. So it can cut the pipelines inside, and the system can have permanent physical damage. It can implode into itself, and at the outlet side it will not be able to supply enough refrigerant to go out, and it may increase the temperature to higher values that condenser might not be able to fully condense. So there will be increase in electrical power consumption at the compressor, and also overall reduction in mass flow rate throughout the system, and hence there will be lesser tons of refrigeration produced by the system, and overall the system will be highly affected in the terms of efficiency and physical damage part. Now coming over to the common refrigerant absorbent systems. So in this case, what do we have? We have some requirements of the refrigerant to be able to work in this kind of system. Are the refrigerant properties covered by the bus sir in his class?
Yes, sir.
Refrigerant property not covered by him?
Already I pointed out a couple of things. It's okay for myself. Thank you,
sir.
Okay, no issues. So what we'll be doing is, we will be just discussing in brief and then moving on to the specific requirements for the refrigerant absorbent pair. Because in the vapor compression system, we are having only one single working fluid, which is refrigerant. But in the case of vapor absorption system, we are having a pair of working fluids, because we are having two systems working simultaneously, together with each other, and hence we are having two different working fluids. So we will be having a requirement to specifically for this pair. So in the case of refrigerant, whatever desirable characteristics are there, that will be applicable to the refrigerant part of this pair. And basically some of the requirements which are of importance here specifically are low viscosity to minimize pump work, because pump has to deal with a refrigerant absorbent solution. So the solution which would be prepared or which would be generated in the absorber is required to be pumped to the generator. So to minimize the pumping work, we should have low viscosity of this pair or solution, then low freezing point. So if the freezing point is low, then the refrigerant absorbent pair may freeze in the absorber and hence may be unable to be pumped. The freezing point should be low so that it is in the liquid state. Absorber is cool. Absorber is being supplied with low temperature refrigerant vapors, so it is at a lower temperature, and at that lower temperature, if the refrigerant absorbent pair freezes, then there will be a problem in the operation of the system. So hence freezing point should be low. Then good chemical and thermal stability, because if they are chemically reactive, then they will not be able to be separated, because reverse chemical reaction is required then. So they must not react chemically, they should be stable as well as chemically as well as thermally. So because we are having change in temperatures at the absorber side, lower temperatures are there, at the generator side we are having higher temperatures, and it is being supplied with high temperature fluid for heat transfer. So if they any of the component is getting decomposed, there will be a problem. So they should be stable. Then irreversible chemicals of all kinds, such as decomposition, polymerization, corrosion, etc., are to be avoided. So these are some of the requirements. Then two thermodynamics requirements are also there, which are of most important value, and that would be the major deciding factor to select refrigerant absorbent pair as a working fluid in this type of system. First of them is solubility requirement, second is boiling point requirement. So as we are required to dissolve or absorb refrigerant into the solution of a weak refrigerant solution which is in the absorbent, so the absorbent must make a strong solution which is highly rich in refrigerant, and it is formed in the absorber by absorption of the refrigerant vapor. So refrigerant must have more than Raoult's law solubility in the absorbent. So we are required to select this pair of such a kind that more and more refrigerant can be solubilized and the solution is not easy to saturate out. So it must be able to dissolve more and more refrigerant vapors so as to form a solution. Are you getting this requirement? So the solubility requirement is specifically for this absorption system. Other requirements would be general for all systems, all kind of refrigeration systems which have refrigerants. Then boiling point requirement. Boiling point requirement, here it means the difference in boiling point. There should be large difference in normal boiling point of two substances. So at least 200 degrees Celsius is recommended
in every district.
Because at the generator, what we are required to do is, we are required to supply the heat, and from that heat, we are required to boil off the refrigerant, and while the refrigerant is boiling off, absorbent must not boil. So, the vapors of absorbents must not form at the generator, and only refrigerant vapors should form, because if the absorbent also boils off, it will also go to the refrigerant circuit along with the refrigerant, because after generator, we are having a vapor line going to the condenser where refrigerant is required to be condensed, and if through that line along with refrigerant absorbent also vaporizes and goes to the condenser, it will be stopping or it will be having a blocking kind of effect in that pipeline. Because some of the area, cross-sectional area, will be occupied by the absorbent vapors, and they are choking the pipeline or used for supplying refrigerant to the refrigerant circuit. So overall mass flow rate of refrigerant through the refrigerant circuit will reduce, and that will bring down the cooling capacity of the system, and also there can be cases where absorbent is not able to act like refrigerant, it is not able to get condensed, or it is not able to get evaporated at the evaporator temperatures. So in that case there would be more problems. So refrigerant should go to refrigerant circuit, absorbent should not leave the absorbent circuit or solution circuit. So it has to remain in the solution circuit only. So that is why these 200 degrees Celsius boiling point difference is recommended between refrigerant and absorbent, so that only refrigerant evaporates. But as we know that all substances in liquid phase, they evaporate at all temperatures. The rate of evaporation is dependent on temperature. If temperatures are low, rate of evaporation is low. If temperatures are high, rate of evaporation are high. So we cannot fully contain the absorbent in the solution circuit. Some of the absorbent can leave. Now coming on to the pairs itself, the two commonly used pairs are these: ammonia as an absorbent, as a refrigerant in the water as an absorbent, then water as a refrigerant in lithium bromide as an absorbent. So we are having two commonly used pair for vapor absorption refrigeration system. One of the pair is ammonia water system, in which ammonia is refrigerant and water is absorbent. Another system is water lithium bromide system, in which water is refrigerant and lithium bromide is absorbent. So let us analyze both the system. In the case of ammonia water system, what we have is, as ammonia forms highly non-ideal solution in water, so solubility requirements are met, but boiling point difference requirement is not. So we are having a difference in boiling point 138 degrees Celsius between the ammonia and water at the operating pressures of the system. Hence, vapor leaving the generator will contain some amount of water. So if water is also going along with the ammonia refrigerant in the refrigeration circuit, then water may freeze in the evaporator. Water may form ice crystal in the capillary tube in the expansion wall, it may choke it. So there can be some problems, and hence this is not suitable from the point of view of boiling point requirement. So as such, in the system till which we have studied till now, it will not be suitable like that. So we are required to do some changes. Either we are required to do some changes to the system, or we are required to do some changes to this pair. So let us see what we can do after we analyze the second part, which is water lithium bromide system. Here, what do we have is that we are having this as we are using water as refrigerant. So water, as it reaches at 0 degrees Celsius, that is only used in air conditioning applications, because at less than 0 degrees Celsius water will not flow. So refrigerant itself will cease to flow, it cannot be used. Then mixture is non-ideal but is satisfactory. So from the solubility point of view requirement, it is okay. And as lithium bromide is a salt, it exerts no water pressure. That means boiling point requirement is also okay. So vapor leaving generator is pure water, no lithium bromide evaporates. Because lithium bromide is a salt, it is a solid, it does not evaporate at the generator operating temperature and pressure also. So it satisfies boiling point requirement as well. But still, it is corrosive and plant work under high reaction, both in condenser and evaporator. Hence, a purge unit will be used. Are you getting this?
They have to travel to sell their products. So that is the another hurdle which we have witnessed. Then potential buyers of the day showing interest
in low-cost products. Just like the refrigeration chart, refrigerant charts which you might have used in the previous class, pH charts. So those charts depict the refrigeration cycle, compression cycle, onto a chart which can geometrically show how the cycle is working. Similarly, for vapor absorption case, we are having some charts which are thermodynamics property of selected system. So refrigeration charts are for selected refrigerant. So here also aqua ammonium system means water ammonia system. There are some tables by Janning and Shannon. Then we are having Kolos and Scott. They develop a diagram, and it is also similar to which is data by Scratchard. So what do we do is we study enthalpy composition diagram. It was used by Merkel and Kovic. So they used enthalpy composition diagram, which we will be studying in I think next class, because in this class it would not be possible to cover up to that point. And in that we will be diagrammatically studying that how this cycle can be represented on a graph paper, and then we can analytically go for solving or calculating some parts which are required. But basically, as we have seen up till this point, that we do have some problem with selection of refrigerant absorbent pair. So there are requirement of modification, and these modifications are due to drawbacks. So there are two drawbacks in simple vapor absorption cycle. These are the low temperature of rich solution which is entering generator, and high temperature of poor solution which is entering absorber. So in the previous diagram we saw that low temperature was there of that rich solution.
I want to thank our honorable director for giving whole hearted
support. Let me go to that. So here you are seeing that we are having a low this high temperature solution coming from the generator. Generator is at higher temperature, at higher pressure, and it is giving its contents to the absorber, which is operating at lower temperature and receiving a hot fluid. Absorber is supplying cold fluid to the generator. Generator is operating at higher temperature. So what we can do is, we can have some heat exchanger in between, so that this fluid coming at state 2 can heat the fluid coming at state 1. State 1 fluid's temperature will go down, state 2's fluid temperature will go, state 1's will be going up, state 2 will be going down, and we can have a heat regeneration, and that would be solving this first problem. Second is presence of absorbent in the vapor leaving generator going to the refrigeration circuit. So here, after this generator, at this point number 5, which I have already clearly explained to you in the refrigerant absorbent pair selection, that there is always a chance that along with the refrigerant vapor, some absorbent vapors will also be going to the refrigeration circuit, refrigerant circuit, and we are required to avoid it. So there is second drawback. The drawback is, in this simple diagram, we are having a chance that absorbent vapors can go at this point number 5. So what do we do is, we are required to do some changes, and those changes will be required to solve for those two drawbacks which we had. So what are the solutions? The solution for this particular problem is that we can have this kind of system, that after absorber, you can see in this diagram, this is actual vapor absorption system. After absorber, absorber is rejecting QA heat, it is going to the pump, condition 4, going to the pump. After pump, it has increased some enthalpy, so enthalpy from 4 goes to 4A. Then we are having a regenerative heat exchanger through which this cold fluid is going, and on the other side of heat exchanger, we are having this point 2 coming out at point 3. So hot fluid from the generator going to the absorber will be cooled to some extent, and here we are having this type. So this is solution to drawback number 1. Solution to drawback number 2 is by use of analyzer and deflagmator. So what are the solutions? So what is these two things? Analyzer, this AN, after generator, we are having analyzer. This is just like the fractional distillation column which you might have studied in your plus 2 standard classes, in the topic of petrol, production of petrol from this petrochemicals. So what we are having? We are having a boiler at the bottom. Boiler is evolving a lot of vapors. Those vapors are mix of various different fluids. It can be refrigerant, it can be absorbent, it can be any other thing, but in the case of this cycle, we are having only two things. So refrigerant is there, absorbent is there. So due to this staggered construction, we are having baffle plates, one baffle plate from this side, another this side, one another, then this side, this side. So what will happen? Vapors are required to take this zigzag path. They cannot move straight up. So straight away they will not be going up. So what will happen in the in their path? We are having these plates, baffle plates. So the lower boiling point temperature fluid, say in this case will be our absorbent, will condense first, because these plates are not heated, not cooled. They are at the temperature whatever is existing in this place. So while going through this staggered conditions, staggered position, the absorbent will be condensed first, refrigerant will be cooled down a bit. Refrigerant was to be cooled down at the condenser, so it has started cooling here only. So it is not being condensed but cooled. So it will be cooled down, then it is going to condition 5, then it goes to deflagmator. So we are having one more column just like this attached to another unit which is deflagmator. So this is analyzer, and after analyzer we are having this rectifier. So D is not here, D is here. So this is deflagmator and this column is rectifier. So rectifier is continuing the work of analyzer. Then after deflagmator it goes to one more unit in which we are supplying cooling pulse. So what it will do is whatever very minute quantity absorbent vapor are still present up till this level will be condensed on that cooling pulse. So here you can see QR amount of heat is being rejected from this point. So there is a condenser kind of cooling coil. So on that cooling coil absorbent will get condensed, refrigerant will cool down further, refrigerant will be condensed in the condenser only. So whatever superheated refrigerant you are having, that superheat may be rejected.
Some of the stipulations coming.
Are you getting this?
Like you have to show the expiry date.
So this is rectifier or rectifier for rectifying column. This. This part, this is deflagmator from where this QR heat has been detected.
Help them to get registered.
And this is analyzer. Analyzer is also known as exhausting column.
Giving training to the women, we have emphasized the need for
students. Are you getting this?
They have to go into the market and do serious marketing. We have emphasized the need of need for.
So after this rectifier.
We have given deflagmator.
After rectifier, there is deflagmator. After deflagmator, it goes to condenser. After condenser, we are having one more modification. This is HE1, which is heat exchanger 1. What it does is, it is cooling the incoming condensed refrigerant before going to the expansion valve. So here you are seeing, this is V1, valve 1, expansion valve 1, V2, valve 2. Both are pressure reducing valve. Expansion valve is also pressure reducing valve. This valve to V2 is also pressure reducing valve. So here after condenser we are having liquid refrigerant at ambient temperature and high pressure. So if we subcool this refrigerant, its cooling effect would be higher. So outgoing vapor refrigerant which were going to the absorber are used in this regenerative heat exchanger to heat to cool this incoming liquid refrigerant. So from ambient temperature it will be brought down to a lower value, so that before this expansion valve it is brought down to a subcooled state, and then it will be providing much more cooling capacity at the evaporator. So this is additional modification which was not with respect to the drawbacks of the system, but it is an improvement to the system overall. And these values are the values of the flow rate. So D is the flow rate of refrigerant. So D kg amount of refrigerant is going at condition 7 to the refrigeration circuit. And F is the amount of solution, and F minus D will be going back to the absorber. So F amount of solution is there, then from this F amount of solution D has been removed, so F minus D will be coming down to the absorber again. And as D has gone to this refrigerant circuit, so from this condition 12, this is only D amount only, because in between there is no change. Now coming on to cycle representation. Basically, I also hinted you regarding that as we represent vapor compression cycle on refrigeration charts, similarly vapor absorption cycle can be represented geometrically on a enthalpy composition diagram. So at this side of this page here you can see this is the enthalpy composition diagram. So in this diagram we are having two axis, x-axis and y-axis. On the x-axis we are having this composition, and on the y-axis we are having enthalpy. So what do we mean by this composition? Basically enthalpy, you are already familiar about what is enthalpy. Now coming on to the composition part of it, so here in this side on the x-axis we are having composition represented by this Greek symbol eta. So in this Greek symbol eta, what does this represent? Basically, as in the absorption system case, the working fluid for the solution circuit is refrigerant absorbent pair. Basically, it is a mixture of two substances, and the relative concentration of one substance as compared with other substance changes through within the cycle as the solution goes through the circuit. Okay, so how do we represent that change is by this composition. So basically this composition axis, this x-axis, its range is from 0 to 1. So on the positive x-axis direction it increases up to 1, and at the start it would be 0. So composition 0, what would it mean? It will mean that it is having a pure substance. And what pure substance are we talking about? Is the absorbent or the refrigerant. As we are dealing with the refrigeration system, and hence our target component of the solution is the refrigerant, so the range of composition on the composition axis is with respect to refrigerant. So this composition 0 at this side would be meaning that we are having a pure absorbent and no refrigerant in that particular solution state, whether it is liquid or it is vapor. In any case, when we are having any point in the starting of the graph, then that is indicating that we are having lesser of refrigerant and more of absorbent. As our point representing the state of the mixture moves towards the right side of the graph, then it is representing more of the refrigerant and less of the absorbent. So basically this eta here, this is in the starting or beginning, its value would be 0. At the ending or edge part, finishing part of this graph, its value would be 1. So we are seeing four curves have been drawn on this diagram. This curve, this value Tk, this value To, this is representing the pressures, because we are having enthalpy on the y-axis. For pressure, we will be having two different curves. So similarly, we are having Tk and To here as well. So Tk pressure curve is this as well this. So how we can have two different curves for a same pressure is because of change in phase. So when we are having vapor state, so refrigerant absorbent mixture, both of them are in vapor state, then this curve will be applicable. And when both of them are in liquid state, then this curve will be applicable. Are you getting this? So just leave these points 1, 2, 3, 4 or whatever numbers are there. You just see that what these curves are indicating. So this Pk here as well as here, these two curves would be meeting somewhere around like say here at this point. So when this curve and this curve will be meeting, so that would indicate pure refrigerant. At this point, it would be indicating pure refrigerant, and the value of this eta here would be 1. So this particular graph has been cut out from the whole complete picture of the graph. So basically how this diagram looks like, I'll just show you. So this is just like this. So we would be having meeting points of different curves. So here say it is PO, upper curve is for vapor, lower curve is for liquid. So when liquid vapor both are meeting here, so in that case here we will be having the value of eta as 1, and this would be indicating pure refrigerant at PO pressure, and this point will be indicating pure refrigerant at Pk pressure. On the x-axis or y-axis we would be reading out the other element. So this is not the composition enthalpy chart, but it is similar to that. So on here we are having on y-axis temperature instead of enthalpy, but the concept is same. Are you getting this?
Yes sir.
So we would be having two these kinds of shapes, and hence we would be having four different curves. So at PK pressure, we are adding two curves. This is vapor line, this is liquid line. Similarly, PO pressure, vapor line, liquid line. And the point where vapor liquid meets, lines meets, that is the saturated condition. So this side saturated refrigerant at this pressure, saturated refrigerant at this pressure. This side saturated absorbent at this pressure, and this side saturated absorbent at this particular pressure. Okay, so from this diagram, a small part, say this much part, has been extracted out and zoomed into. So up till here it is clear what this graph is indicating. So this PK and this PK would be meeting outside somewhere here. So that would be pure refrigerant at PK. And similarly PO, this line, PO, this line would also be meeting somewhere at the same x-axis coordinate but different y-axis coordinate. So that would be pure refrigerant at PO pressure. Similarly, both of these lines would be meeting somewhere here as well, or say here as well. So that would be indicating pure absorbent at that particular pressure, which whose lines we are meeting. Okay, so now the representation of this cycle. So let us see in this particular diagram. This was the actual vapor absorption system. In this, the states which we have discussed are already marked onto the diagram. So same states we would be marking on this enthalpy composition diagram as well. So here we are seeing that this state of the state 1 of this diagram, where is it starting? So starting point is say somewhere around here. So 1A state is existing at this point, and at this point what is happening, we are having a rich solution of refrigerant from absorber pumped through a heat exchanger. So it has also been heated. As this solution has been heated, so this solution is already started evaporating. As this solution has already started evaporating, so this is not in pure liquid or pure vapor state. So it would be having some dryness fraction to it. It is neither pure liquid nor pure vapor. Hence, this is the representation of this point on the chart. So this is falling in between these two curves. Both of these curves are liquid lines, but at this particular point, as we have raised the pressure from PO pressure, what was PO pressure? PO pressure was the pressure of evaporator. Evaporator is operating at the lowest pressure PO, and condenser is operating at ambient or higher pressure PK. So from evaporator same pressure has been maintained, so this would be in the PO pressure range. So this pump PO, as pump has increased some of the pressure, it has gone to this point and it is now being sent to the generator side where PK pressure is required to be maintained. So it has not reached PK pressure, but it is near to that. So point 1 has reached here, then that would be point 1. This is point 1A before, then one point is at the generator side. Then what happens, from the generator we are having this stream 2. So this stream 2 is at this side. Why? Because generator has removed refrigerant out of this solution coming into the generator by boiling it, evaporating it, and hence the composition decreases, but it is in the liquid only state. So it would be on the only liquid line, but it has to be on this side. So towards this side we will be having point 2, and this is here you are seeing, this is at TH temperature. So because here we were having heating, and that heating was at TH temperature. So at TH temperature we are having conditions 2. It has been sent to the heat exchanger, and then after heat exchanger it comes to condition 3. So condition 3 is also a pure liquid, but now this pure liquid is coming to the absorber. So this 3 and 3A state both are at the same point at PO pressure, and it is coming to the absorber. Hence it is on the PO pressure, and then it will again after absorber, because it has been fed with the refrigerant vapor, it will become rich solution. So on this PO pressure line the composition increases. So this is eta A composition, which is coming to the absorber and eta R composition, which is going to the generator. Now what else is happening? So here you are seeing other points. So this point 5, this point 6, then this point 7. So several other things are happening above this generator in the analyzer, rectifier and deflagmator side. So what happens from this condition 1, because it has reached here and it is now going to this generator, it has been evaporated by this generator. So it will now be not on this liquid line. These two are both liquid lines. These two are both vapor lines. So what it will do is, it will go to the corresponding vapor line. So this condition 5 is at this same pressure PK. This PK and this PK both are same. So this is liquid line for PK. This is vapor line for PK. So it has reached to this point 5 here. Now what about this line? What does this line is indicating or suggesting? So this is its path of travel which it takes. So it has reached the eta D, which is the deflagmator composition. So at this deflagmator composition, in this side we are giving the composition at this deflagmator side. So eta D it reaches here, then it will become 0.5. because it has come out of analyzer and now going to the next part. Then at the next part, after this it becomes 7. Now what this deflagmator is doing, it is increasing the composition. It is reducing the absorbent part of it and increasing the refrigerant part of it. So it becomes 0.7. So here you are seeing 7V and 7L. So 7V is vapor state, 7L is liquid state. So at this particular condition, it is coming out of the solution circuit. So at the same pressure PK, here as well as here, from 0.5 composition increases to 0.7, and there is some drip going back. So because some of the refrigerant might condense here, so that will be going back through this part via this composition 6 into this side. So this composition 1 and 6 are same. So this is 6 going from this component to this component, and this is 1 entering at this side. So both of them will become a common condition. So hence this is 0.1 as well as 0.6. As this 0.7 is having a better composition, it has increased in composition, so it will be moving towards the right side in this graph, and hence the liquid line will also go towards the right side as well. So this is at T7 temperature. So this condition 7, this is at temperature number 7, T, or at state 7, T7. So this is the T7 line. So this is the deflagmator temperature line. So at this deflagmator temperature line, we will be having vapor and liquid states. So in the vapor state, it is going to the condenser here. In the liquid state, it is coming back to the analyzer here. Okay. So we are right now just locating the points onto this graph, and then we will be going on to the analysis of this graph. So from 0.7, what is then happening? Here you will be seeing that we are having several other points also to be traversed. So from 0.7, after condenser, it reaches condition 8. So after condenser, it becomes liquid at same pressure. So what we are having, because this condenser, now we were having pure refrigerant only, or whatever was the condition, whether it was a mixture or pure substance, everything condenses. Nothing is in vapor state after condenser. So on the x-axis side, we will be having straight vertical line. So this 7V and 8 are falling at the same vertical line at the same pressure as well. So this PK pressure here, PK pressure here, 7V and 8. So this is the location of point number 8, which is after condenser. So what we are having in the refrigerant circuit side is that from condition 7 to condition 12, whatever is going is coming back with respect to composition. So whether it was a pure refrigerant or it was a refrigerant absorbent mixture, whatever percentage composition of refrigerant absorbent was there at 0.7 is the same maintained till 0.12. So 0.7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, all will fall on same vertical line. So last point I said was that from 0.7 till 0.12, whatever composition is going out of the solution circuit in the refrigeration circuit, from 0.7 it has entered condenser and up till 0.12 it was in the refrigeration circuit side. After 0.12 it has entered the solution circuit. So from 0.7 to 0.12 it is the same mixture which was sent after this D-flag method. So suppose if we were having 10% absorbent, 90% refrigerant at 0.7, same will be the case here at 0.12. Because in between there is no separation of refrigerant and absorbent. Whether it is liquid or vapor, doesn't matter. Whatever separation or mixing is there, it is in this part only. This absorber, generator, rectifier, deflagmeter, analyzer, whatever is on the solution circuit part. So what it means? It means whatever composition is existing at 0.7, same composition exists at 0.8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. So it means all these points 7, 8, 9, 11 and 12 are on the same vertical line. Because on the x-axis we were having composition and composition is not changing. Okay, so whole refrigeration cycle is a vertical line in this enthalpy composition diagram. So up till here we have located 0.7, 7 is vapor, so 7V is the point which has exited from this solution circuit. Then after condenser it converts liquid, same pressure, so in the same vertical line, same pressure line, this is 0.8. After 0.8 it has gone through a heat exchanger, so there will be some increase in enthalpy. Okay, increase in enthalpy is expected, but at the same time, because it has been cooled down, not heated, this heat exchanger is not heating this stream. 8 to 9 is a cooling process, 11 to 12 is a heating process. Are you getting this? What this heat exchanger is doing? It is not heating this incoming stream, it is pre-cooling or sub-cooling it. So before it goes, this refrigerant goes to the expansion valve, it has been sub-cooled by using this heat exchanger. So from 0.8 to 0.9, there will be a decrease in enthalpy. Okay? And there will also be a decrease in pressure. Line pressure losses would be there. So we are expecting that, say, the pressure existing at this particular point and this particular point is same. So after 0.8, the point number 9 and 10 are a bit, after this point 10 it goes to 11. So here it has been converted into vapors. So 10 to 11, this is at PO pressure, evaporator pressure. So at this evaporator pressure, what will happen? At this evaporator pressure, we will be having a conversion from liquid to vapor. So here we will be seeing that 0.11. So this is the 0.11 because now it has been increased in enthalpy because it has received some heat. This QO amount, Q naught amount of heat has been input into this, working fluid. So its state has changed to 0.11 here. Because at 0.11, we are having a mixture of liquid and vapor because it has been not fully converted. So it is neither on liquid line nor on vapor line. So what this 0.11 is indicating, just like this 0.9 and 10, what we were having is this was 10L and 10V. So what was the 10L and 10V? This is corresponding to liquid at state 10 and liquid at state vapor at state 10. So both at PO pressure we were having 10L and 10V. So if we join a line from 10L and 10V and it is cutting this vertical line on this this side which is going to the refrigerant circuit, this composition side, then we get this 0.910. Similarly at 0.11 it is a mixture of liquid and vapor. So 11L is liquid, so it is at PO pressure, and at PO pressure only 11V is there. If we join this and cut this line, vertical line, we get 0.11. Same for 0.12 because it is now being heated. From 11 to 12 there is some heat addition because some of the heat transfer has taken place in this heat exchanger for subcooling from 8 to 9. So 11 to 12, there is some rise in enthalpy. And still, it is a mixture of liquid and vapor. So again, 12L at PO pressure, 12B at PO pressure, and we get 0.12 here. Okay, so on this refrigeration circuit side of this diagram, what we are having is, we are having 0.7, then this moves to 0.8, then moves to 0.9, then 11, then 12. So this is a purely vertical line. So here at 0.11 to 12, there was heating in the heat exchanger, and hence the point 0.12 would be a bit higher than 0.11, and both of these two points as well as other points 9, 10. So as all of these are not purely liquid or vapor states, so they are a mixture of liquid and vapor phases. So we can represent this by intersection of two lines. So if we see at 0.11, this is state when 0.11 is liquid, this is 0.11 when it is vapor. So liquid and vapor, when both points are joined together, then we are forming this dotted line, and it is intersecting with this vertical line, and then we will be locating this 0.11 here. Similarly for 0.12 as well as 0.9. So this side liquid line, this side vapor line, same pressure we would take. This is PO pressure, this is PO pressure. So at PO pressure vapor line and PO pressure liquid line, the same state we are having, and we can join that state together and find the intersection point on this vertical line. So this side, this line, this is indicating the composition going to the refrigeration circuit, and this is composition going to the deflagmator. This is composition of rich solution, this is composition of weak solution from the absorber. So at absorber we are having this solution coming into it, increases to this composition rich solution. Then at deflagmator, this is the point which we are having. So this is from deflagmator. After deflagmator, we will be having further increase which is going to the refrigeration circuit. So this is eta E. So these are various points which we can have on this this composition side. So at the bottom we are seeing this F total, indicating total. One is in between this absorber and rich solution, and F minus one is this remaining part. So what is this indicating? This is indicating the specific flow rates. So this F overall total, this F is specific rich solution circulation rate. So how much rich solution has been circulated from absorber to generator, this is the rate of flow of that particular thing. Then if we indicate, or if we say that out of this total F, this difference between this rich and weak solution, if it is 1, then what else remains is F minus 1. So F minus 1 is specific weak solution circulation rate. So this from 0.2, it is coming back to absorber. So at 0.2, we are having a different flow rate than at 0.1. So at 0.1, we are having F kg per second flow rate. At 0.2, we are having F minus D kg per flow rate. And D kg per second of flow rate is going to 0.7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Because whatever is going at 0.7 is coming back at 0.12. So this D kg per second flow rate is maintained in between these conditions 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. So out of this total F at 0.1 going to the generator, it is splitting it into two parts, and those two parts are F minus D going back to the absorber and D going to the condenser. And at 0.12 it is going back to the absorber, so that this F minus D and this D both combine together and make F again. So this F minus D, F and D, we are having three different variables. To reduce the number of variables and to bring it down to a single variable, we use a ratio which is F by D. So if we divide this F by this D, that out of overall rich solution, how much refrigerant can be extracted? So that would be specific rich solution circulation rate. So this is small f is amount of rich solution per kg amount of refrigerant that could be extracted. Okay, on the right hand side you can see this representation of vapor absorption cycle on this diagram, which is enthalpy composition diagram. Now based on this diagram we are required to go for analytical part for this particular cycle. So in this analytical part here you can see what are the calculations that we can do. So basically we will be having these three different things. One is mass balance, then material balance and energy balance. So mass balance means for any system or all through, what we will be having is that there will be no mass leaving the system, no mass entering the system. So altogether we will be having sum of all masses equal to zero. So from the system and on the to the system, all masses will be summed as zero. So if we take any point, any node, then sum of masses entering that point minus sum of mass exiting that point will be zero. Similarly will be the case for material as well as enthalpy. So material balance means, which is partial mass balance, so mass into its composition. So sum of these weighted or partial masses will be also zero. And energy balance means total heat energy. So whether it is in the form of given to the system or taken from the system, as well as whatever enthalpy change is there. So sum of all these three will be zero. So with respect to this diagram, we can formulate these three different equations such that if we are having a pump which is supplying this F amount of mass for feed and it is distilling D amount of that refrigerant, so F minus D will be the weak solution which would be going back to the this absorber. So in the previous diagram here, in this case we were having, this was deflagmator and this was analyzer. So we are seeing that this pump is pumping F kg mass, and from this F kg mass, D kg mass is going to this refrigeration side, F minus D is coming back to this absorber side. So what we are having is, if we are looking at this particular point, so F is incoming, D is outgoing, F minus D is outgoing. So all three all together when we sum up, then we will get this first equation, delta M is equal to 0. Now coming on to partial material balance, so we are having this particular equation in terms of these variables. So the variables which we can easily see in this diagram here, so what are these variables? So we are required to have mass into composition. So mass of this solution is F, capital F, its composition. So here we are seeing that this was the composition. So this is eta R. Then this eta R here, that is in the liquid state or liquid phase. So this eta R is not on this side, but it is on this liquid line. So whether it is at PO or PK, in both cases it is eta R liquid. So we can also write L over here. So on the in the subscript or superscript side, we can also denote it as L. So as to have, because this eta R line will cut all four curves, but we are only required to see this liquid line only. Similarly, F minus D, this was the stream going back to the absorber. So it is having eta A, and then rest of them was having higher composition. This is eta E. So D amount into eta E, that would be the second balance, material balance. And in the from this graph, from this chart, we can see that eta R, so this eta R is equal to eta 1A. So eta 1A, 1A is here, and eta A, this eta A is equal to eta 2, this is 0.2. So this is same. Then eta E, this eta E is equal to eta 7, but here eta 7 on this side, this is eta 7 B, not L, because 0.7 L and 0.7 B are having different eta values. So that is why I in the starting I told you that we can also denote it with this superscript. So this superscript have been dropped in this particular notation. Now by comparing these two, this equation and this equation, where is this equation? This equation is that F plus D plus minus this equal this all these three when we will be summing, this is summation of n is equal to 0. And if we denote this specific circulation rate of rich solution, which can be denoted by small f and calculated as this value capital F by D. What was capital F? Capital F was the solution, rich solution, which was pumped from absorber to generator, and D is the amount of refrigerant going to the refrigeration circuit. So out of overall total solution being handled by the pump, how much refrigerant was going? So per unit refrigerant, if we calculate, so it is F by D, because D was refrigerant. So if we divide this capital F by D, we will get a specific rate of circulation. And circulation of what? Circulation of this F. F was rich solution. Okay. And F minus D is weak solution. So from this balance equations, these equations, we can see that it is equal to eta E minus eta A upon eta R minus eta A. So this subscript here, so if we simplify the this particular value here, we can see that this subscript here, this is not subscript, the denominator side, this is also known as degassing rate. So eta R minus eta A, so this is eta R, this is eta A. So this was the solution being pumped by the pump. So it is rich solution getting pumped into generator, and from the generator this was the returning back to absorber. So eta A composition coming back to absorber, eta R going to the generator. So from absorber, so absorber is supplying eta R composition, generator is giving it back eta A composition. So basically generator is removing this difference, and that difference eta R minus eta A, which is in the denominator of this equation, is known as degassing range. So to calculate the value of F from this graph geometrically, so this is F, so this comes out to be this one part. So if we are taking this whole difference of composition as F, so this particular difference, which is on the denominator side, is 1, the rest of it is F minus 1, because this plus this will become total. So if it is 1, then this is F. So as we have seen the specific rich solution circulation, this F, similarly specific weak solution circulation will be in place of F on this top side, or on the upper side we will get F minus D, so divided by D, and here we will be getting the denominator is same. So whatever denominator is here also, and now we are having eta E minus eta R. So this eta E minus eta R, so this is the difference of this side. So to get this F minus 1, this F minus 1, so this is eta E and eta R, difference between these two, and to get this F, so this F is corresponding to this side, so it is eta R minus eta A, and on this denominator side we are having same values. Are you getting this? So on the denominator side, this eta R minus eta A is called as degassing range. So these two values, F and F minus 1, these are circulation rates. If we are reducing the rate of circulation of these two quantities, then we will be having a higher COP, because they are affecting COP. So what we can see here is lower solution circulation rates are going to get us a higher COP, and it can be seen as mainly depends on the value of this range. This range, this was degassing range. So it is highly dependent on this degassing range. And this degassing range should be as large as possible. So the difference between these two compositions, because this is the composition which the generator is able to remove. Absorber is supplying rich solution and giving back weak solution. So if we are having a large difference between this richness or weakness of this solution in terms of percentage concentration of refrigerant, so most of the refrigerant may be removed by generator, and if it can be done, then mass flow rate of refrigerant per unit flow rate of overall rich solution will increase, and in also lead to increase in refrigeration effect, which in turn will increase the COP of the system. So that is why this degassing range, this denominator term, is of utmost importance in this particular case. So what does that mean? We are required to increase the value of eta R minus eta A. How can this be done? Is either you increase the value of eta R as high as possible, means we increase the richness of rich solution sent by absorber, or decrease the value of eta A, means weakness of weak solution coming back from the generator to the absorber, or do both. So to increase or to get highest possible COP from the absorption system, eta R should be as high as possible, eta A should be as low as possible. And if we combine these both, then degassing range will be as high as possible. So this is the degassing range, and this is what I just told you. So this will happen when refrigerant has more than Raoult's law solubility in absorbent at absorber temperature, and when normal boiling points of refrigerant and absorbent are wide apart. So these were the two major requirements of refrigerant absorbent pairs in to be used in vapor absorption refrigeration system, and these two requirements are coming as a result of this particular mathematical analysis. So what we can see is that in this particular case, to have these things at the highest possible values, we are required to increase this quantity eta E to be as high as possible. Why? Because this particular composition is the refrigerant which is going into the refrigeration circuit. So if it is going to the refrigeration circuit, it should be a pure refrigerant, and there should be no absorbent present in this particular solution or in this particular stream. So that means we are targeting that eta E should be equal to 1, which is the highest possible value of composition in this case. And also here we can see this was eta D. Eta D was which was going to the deflagmator, and this should be also as high as possible, means eta D should be equal to eta A, should be equal to 1. So this was the case which I told to you, that eta E equal to eta D equal to 1. Then what will happen? These equations for F and F minus 1 will change to this equation. So at the bottom we are having the same degassing range, but on the top what we are having is now that 1 minus Ea is corresponding to eta A is corresponding to the F, and 1 minus R is corresponding to eta R is corresponding to F minus 1. So this circulation rate, solution circulation rate is corresponding to 1 minus this quantity, and this weak solution circulation rate is corresponding to 1 minus this quantity. So these would be the values that we can have. Now energy balance, so this was regarding the mass and material balance only. If we go on to energy balance part, so here you can see these are the energy balance parts. So this state 5 and 7, these are same. This state 5 and 7 are same. So using this thermodynamics equation, this enthalpy balance equation, what we can have it here is that QH plus F times H1A is equal to H5 plus F minus 1 H2. So here what is happening? Basically, this is the case when we are having generator without deflagmator. Means if we are not having deflagmator, this point 5 and 7 will coincide, and this will be one single point, because what deflagmator was doing? Deflagmator was further increasing this composition from eta D to eta E. If we are not having deflagmator, then eta D is equals to eta D, and this 0.5 and 0.7 is one single point. So if it is one single point, rest all are on the same line, vertical line, so everything else will be lining up at this position, or if this 0.5 moves here, then this is the position which we will be referring to. So this QH was the amount of heat energy required to be given to the generator for evolving, for boiling of the refrigerant, can be solved for by using this equation. So it is just a rearrangement of this particular equation, and here we are having this final values given to you as here. Now here what we are having is, we are having an introduction of auxiliary quantity. So this is basically an imaginary quantity, and basically this would be used as a replacement of this term here. So if we replace this total term as H, capital H, so it is H5 minus H capital H, just like this equation. So what we can see is capital H can be written as H2 minus F times H2 minus HA, and that particular quantity, this HH, this quantity on the chart, on this diagram, will be an auxiliary quantity, and that particular auxiliary quantity will be from this particular point. So this is the H point, which is corresponding to this point number 2 here. So this value HH is the value for this point here. So if we read on the y axis at this side, so this will be what its reading we will be getting at. So why is it coming, or why are we even replacing this term, we will be just discussing in some time. Now let us see that if generator is with deflagmator, now if we are having one deflagmator attached to it, then this equation also will be requiring this term added to it, because in the deflagmator part we were having a cooling coil, and with that cooling coil was removing QR amount of heat. So that after including this, we get this particular term, introducing this auxiliary term. Now what we are having is, this is H7 minus H5, previously it was H5, because we considered that 5 and 7 are same, and it is not 7, it is 5 only. Now if we are having a deflagmator, then 5 and 7 are different. Now the final point which is going to the refrigeration side is 7, not 5. So it is now H7 minus HH, this is H remains same, and plus QR, this would be the only change. Now coming on to the liquid-liquid heat exchanger, so in that case it is purely using that Q is equal to mCp delta T. So for that, this is M, mass flow rate, weak solution, Cp of weak solution, delta T for that weak solution part. So after this would be equal to the other side. So other side we are having rich solution, mass, specific heat, and delta T. So mCp delta T weak solution, mCp delta T rich solution. So this would be regarding that liquid-liquid regenerator side. Now these equations can be found from this by rearranging. So this T1A and H1A can be known from these equations. Now one more auxiliary terms at the absorber, we can see at the absorber what is happening. We are having QA amount of heat being absorbed. This is the mass flow rate of rich solution into its enthalpy, because it was 0.4 rich solution enthalpy. Then H12, this is H12 here, this is H12 minus H3 plus, by rearranging this solution we get this. Now again introducing a auxiliary quantity HA, which is defined as this, and point A is coming out to be here. So this is HA is the enthalpy at this point. So QA comes out to be H12, right, minus HA, and previously we had QH is equal to this one, QH is equal to H5 minus HH. So this was HH, and previously we considered this H5. If we are considering H7, so this was H7 along with this QR. So here what we are getting from the graph, what we can see is that on this graph, the difference between enthalpy of 0.7 and 0.5, this is the value of QR, because this is the only difference between this and this. This is with deflagmator, that was without deflagmator, and at deflagmator we are having only this much difference. So H5 minus H7V is QR from the graph, geometrically we can see, and other quantities are already denoted on this particular graph. This is QO, which is refrigeration effect, QA, heat removed at absorber, QH heat given to the generator, and finally we are having this this difference, this this much difference, this was QR. Now basically we are seeing here that for calculation of QH, what are the reference point? Reference point is point number 7 and point H. So here we are having QH is equal to H7 minus HH. So this is HH, this is H7. Okay. If we are also including this deflagmator, then this bar will raise up to this level and this QR term will be included as a difference of H5 and H7. Now coming on to QA, QA now we are seeing that QA is the difference between H12 and HA. So here is QA. QA is H12 and HA. So graphically, this is point number 12 and this is point number A. Now, why I am again and again focusing on these points H and A? Because these two points are not existing in real cycle, but they are auxiliary, or we can say helping points in calculation of these things. So how are they helping? You just see these auxiliary quantities HH and HN. So they are having an important role to play. So what is that important role? That you can see from this graph that if point 2 and 1A, so this is point 2 and 1A, if they are joined and we are extrapolating this line to cross this vertical line, then the point on which they cut is this point H. And why is it important? This is important because what we are having from symmetry, if this particular line at the bottom side, we have denoted this total length as F, EA and EAR difference is 1, EA and ER and EE difference is F minus 1. So distance between 2 and 1A corresponds to 1. Distance between 2 and point H corresponds to F. Distance between 1A and H corresponds to F minus 1. So here is what is happening. So we can calculate this HH value of enthalpy here as H2 minus F times, because we are now taking total distance between point 2 and H, F times. So F times H2 into H2 minus HA, because this was corresponding to 1. So this is how H is calculated, point H is located. Similarly for this point A, this is obtained by joining these two points 3 and 4 and extending it to cut this line. So point 3 and point 4 joined together, extending this line to cut this vertical line. Wherever they cut, this is point A, and here is how it can be defined. HA is equal to H3, this is for H3, minus F times, because this is difference between these two points, H times H3 minus H. Now you got this idea that we from this graph, graphically how we can calculate, how we can know the various values.